The topic that we are going to start today is higher education system, the governance, the polity, and the administration in India. We can if you talk about the Indian education system, mainly we divide Indian education system in two parts. One is a pre-independence period, that is under the British rule, and the second is post-independence period, after the independence. But if you talk about the British, you know, pre-British days, mainly Hindus and Muslims, they used to go to the pathshalas and madrasas. So pathshalas was the place basically where the Hindus went for their higher education, and madrasas where the Muslims went. Initially, you can say like in starting, the Britishers did not show any interest for learning because their main motive is to get the profit out of India. They were a trading company, but still, you know, there were some people, they showed some kind of interest in education. So the first person we can say who showed some interest in case of education in India was Warren Hastings. Warren Hastings ko rights mile the, he got the full rights to trade and administration in Bengal after the Battle of Plassey in 1764 from the Mughals. So he showed some interest for the Oriental education. Oriental education means the original education in India, in which Jonathan Duncan and Nathalie Hedhill and Sir William Jones, you know, helped him out. He joined hands, means he helped him out in pursuing or in following this kind of education here. So first we will start with who was Sir William Jones. Sir William Jones was the Justice of Calcutta High Court, and what he did was he established Asiatic Society at Calcutta in 1784 AD. Basically he started research on Oriental education, means the basic aapka jo local education hai, the way they teach, what is the culture of India. So he mainly emphasized on these two things. Now, after that, we can say at the time of the next Governor General, that is Lord Wellesley, he laid a lot of importance, you know, for education, and he started Fort William College in 1880. This was not for Indians basically. Ye Indians ke liye to bilkul nahi tha. This was mainly for the British civilians, the civilians like the families of the British soldiers and other people who lived there. And basically they learned Indian languages, the laws here, the customs, the religion, and the geography of India. Now the concern is by the endeavor of, you know, Wilkins Jones, Colebrook and William Carey, the Oriental education got a foothold. And jab ye log aaye to in logon ne apna Oriental education ko thoda loss hua inke aane se. Then the first education institute that was established in India was the Calcutta Madrasa. Ye log chahte the ki Indian form, Indian traditional teaching form ko mix kiya jaye with Western education. So they started, it was started at Calcutta and it was a madrasa basically. So that's why they gave it a name, Calcutta Madrasa. It was established in 1781 in Calcutta and it was started by Lord Warren Hastings. The basic purpose, what was the purpose, was the study of the Muslim laws and the related subjects to Muslims, so that they can easily handle the Muslim, you can say the people or the community, deal with them. The second being Sanskrit College. It was established in 1791 at Banaras. Now, it was established by Jonathan Duncan. Purpose behind, like Madrasa, Calcutta Madrasa was Muslim law, here it was Hindu law and the Hindu philosophy. Aisa mana chahta hai ki Hindu philosophy dunya ki sabse purani philosophies mein se ek hai. So that's why, you know, this was established basically to do that. Then the next which was established was Fort William College. Now this was established in 1800 AD and at Calcutta, again set up by Lord Wellesley. The purpose of this was mainly for, you know, training of the civil servants. Ye institute ek civil servants ki production factory tha, jahan pe civil servants ko produce kiya jata tha, and they were taught different languages and customs. Kyunki civil servants ko aapko deal karna hai alag alag logon ke saath, alag alag population ke saath. ना बहुत सारे ऐसे इंस्टीट्यूट्स थे और बहुत सारे ऐसे लोग थे जिन्होंने एंडेवर दिया, दे टुक इनिशिएटिव्स बेसिकली टू यू नो एक्सटेंड द एजुकेशन और यू नो टू इम्प्रूव द एजुकेशन सिस्टम इन इंडिया. सो द फर्स्ट वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट द एंडेवर ऑफ द क्रिश्चियन मिशनरीज. With the coming of the Britishers, we got a lot of Christian missionaries in India. So they took a lot of, you know, interest in the education system. The Christian missionaries were the first to come forward for that. The Baptist missionary, that is William Cammy, his name, he came to India in the year 1793 AD. He, along with his friends, established a Baptist missionary mission in Sirampur in 1880. Now, the first concern was like he wanted to spread the education through Christianity, and even English was his thing. So he established this. They first of all established printing press, and they printed booklets in Bengali initially. After that, first thing that Carey did was like he translated the Ramayana in Hindi, in English language. Ramayana is the holy book of the Hindus, so that he did that. Later on, you know, with his inspiration, the Bible was, you know, converted, or that was translated into Bengali. So basically, with his zeal, with his enthusiasm, with his interest, first English school was established in Sirampur in 1880 AD, which is now known as Sirampur College. So basically, it was his efforts that, you know, the Christian missionaries started working in India. So after that, we talk about the personal endeavor. There were many Britishers and many Indians, you know, which showed a personal endeavor, like, you know, they wanted to improve the education system in India or something like that. So we can talk about those few people who are like Raja Ram Mohan Roy, bahut famous naam Bengal, the first revolutionary, you can say. This another one, Raja Radhakant Dev was there. Then it was Tej Chandra Rai Bahadur of Burdwan. Then we have is David Hare, the watchmaker of Scotland. He was a watchmaker, wo watches banate the wahan par. But he was interested in imparting education. And as I said, the most important name is Raja Ram Mohan Roy. He was basically the father of modern India or the modern education system. He was a kind of a social worker, or unhone bahut sare social works kiye, like unke efforts se sati system ban hua. A law was passed against sati system with Raja Ram Mohan Roy's effort, and he was the first one to establish Anglo-Hindu school in 1815. Because of him, two English schools can be founded in Chunsura and Bhavanipur in 1848. And later on, you know, he came forward after this. Many Indians came forward, you know, to help him out. And later on, Hindu College was established in Calcutta in 1817. And which is today known as Presidency College. So if someone is from Bengal, they would know how popular is this. After the efforts of the Christian missionaries and after the efforts of the personal, you know, individual, the government also showed some kind of, you know, endeavor or interest in the education. And the first charter was passed. Charter means a kind of regulations were passed for education in 1813, according to which 1 lakh rupees per year was sanctioned for the advancement of education in India. उस समय 1 लाख रुपीज बहुत बड़ा अमाउंट था, दैट वॉज डन. बट नाउ केम द कॉन्फ्लिक्ट, नाउ केम द डिबेट, हाउ टू स्पेंड द मनी, इन वॉट वेज. लाइक सम पीपल वॉन्टेड ओरिएंटल एजुकेशन. Oriental education means a traditional Indian education, and some people wanted English education. And Raja Ramon Roy, as I said, he was the supporter of Western education. So he wanted to spend it basically on Western education, but it was not done. So what happened was the General Committee of Public Instructions was formed, and then they decided to spend the money initially starting on the oriental education, and they established Sanskrit College at Calcutta, like we just did earlier, that which were the initial institutes. Then during Lord William Bentinck's rule, 1828 to 1835 AD, there was a change in the education policy. Lord William Bentinck, he appointed Thomas Bingham Mauchly, a renowned educationist and the chairperson of the Committee of Public Instructions. You know, he divided, because as I said, there was earlier also a division or a debate about Oriental education or European education. So it was done. Some people like Prinsep or Colebrook or Wilson, they were in support of the Oriental education, but they were. So these people, this group of people was called Orientalist. But the people like T.B. McCoy, he was a supporter of the European education with Alexander Duff, Sanders, Colvin. And these people, they are called Anglicist. So the people who were a supporter of Oriental education were Orientalist, and the people who were the supporter of Western education was Anglicist. So McCoy, he presented a proposal of advancement of English in 1835, and this is known as McCoy's minutes, or we also say Macaulay's commission. So now we'll talk about the important points or the important recommendations by Mauchly. He, first of all, he expressed his, strong opinion in favor of English education, because we said that, he belongs to an Anglist society. So he was in favor of English education rather than, you can say, Oriental culture or Oriental education. He believed that the natural or the native culture of India is not good, it is corrupted. He thought that it would be better to give, proper teachings to a small number of upper and middle class students. He was not in favor of giving education to, the whole society or the whole number of people, but only to few selected upper class people. He opined that a shelf of European libraries was equal to the whole literature of India and Arab. That means they believe that European culture was much better than the Indian culture. He wanted to create a good number of black Europeans, like Indians, but who are European. So basically his motive was to make the, you can say, kind of slaves for them. Now, the government basically approved McCoy's proposal of education, and they started, in 1835, they started like Calcutta Medical College and Alpiston College at Bombay, which were established on the recommendation of McCoy Commission. Then we have is Lord Auckland. During Lord Auckland's time, government sectioned more money. Earlier we remember that according to the charter of 1813, only 1 lakh rupees was rewarded or awarded for the education, but now more money was awarded, and that too for the anglicized education in India. In 1942, the Public Instruction Committee was rejected, and Charleswood, there was an education board, Council of Education was formed under the chairmanship of Charles Wood. There were few Indian members also, but you can say equal to zero. And they recommended a lot of proposals for education, which is known as Wood's Dispatch. So let's see what are the proposals. First of all, he gave instruction to regularize the education system from primary to university level. Means he gave the instructions like how should be the primary education, then higher, and then university. So he explained or he gave instructions how he should be there. He also instructed to educate pupil in both English and vernacular language. Vernacular means their local mother tongue, whatever they have. Woods also emphasized on the female education. He believed that, you know, if female would be educated, it will be very good for them. And by his recommendation, education department, a different education department in the government was established. And in 1857, Calcutta, Bombay and Madras universities was established for the first time. During the time of, you can say, Lord Dalhousie, another governor of India, he laid the actual foundation of the modern education in India. During his time, government gave official support for female education. Earlier it was on papers, but not officially, openly government supported it, but during this time it happened. And after the success of the Civil Engineering College, which was established in 1847, he extended the technical education to Bengal, Bombay and Madras. In 1982, we know that after the revolt of 1857, the control of East India Company was ended and the whole of the country went directly under the Queen's rule. So in 1882, Lord Ripon was appointed as the first education commission. He appointed the first education commission under the chairmanship of William Hunter, which had 20 members, and Hunter Commission gave many recommendations. So we are going to talk about it one by one. The first is, like, in the higher and the senior education level, the gradual withdrawal of the government would be there. I mean, he believed that education should not be totally in the hands of the government, but they should withdraw slowly from the government rule. He believed that we should have a liberal and judicial use of the system of grants. Means the grants should be given to the private institutes or the people to make institutes, open the institutes, but that should be only on the basis of staff strength. Their maintenance expenditures, how much money they spend on expenditures, maintenance, and the efficiency of the institute. How good are the institutes? Whether they give proper education, good education or not. It even made recommendations for the subjects for jobs, means job-oriented courses to be launched, and higher study abroad. He also recommended that people who study in India, they can have the opportunity to go abroad to study there. It recommended for the primary education of the backward and the low classes through waiver of fees. First time in India someone made recommendation for the backward classes, and that too, you can say, with the waivers of the fees. Waivers means you get compensations or discounts or scholarships like that. Hunter Commission also recommended for the education of Muslims by opening primary school and high school. He believed that, you know, the education that Muslims get is not up to the mark. So he wanted some separate education system for the Muslim people. To promote girl education, he recommended grants to open girl schools. Hunter Commission was not satisfied with the number of schools for the girls. So he wanted to have more girl schools for them. It also suggested separate schools for the education of princes and children of royal families, a complete example of divide, you can say, and rule. They wanted separate schools, you know, for the princes and the royal family, and separate schools for maybe the Muslims or the common people. Then this commission also laid stress on the physical education. They believe that physical education is equally important, so they laid emphasis on that. So provision of some sports activities in colleges and schools will also recommended. He also laid stress on the moral education. Like, he believed that we should teach these moral educations or moral values in the schools. And today we have in the schools the same thing, we do that. Hunter Commission also, you know, laid emphasis on the vocational and adult education, which became very important in the today's world, if you talk about. Then the government accepted many recommendations of the Hunter Commission, basically. And the first and the most important is the withdrawal of the government grants. Earlier, it was all in the hands of the government. So slowly and slowly, government reduced or withdrew from that. And because of that, many private institutions, they came up. Many. I mean, many Indians, they started, you know, opening up their institutes and all that. In 1902, Lord Curzon, he appointed Indian Universities Commission. Basically, the reason was he was not satisfied with the workings of the universities. The reason was to work into the efficiency of the universities. How can we improve the efficiency? This commission, it recommended first, the syndicate of each university should fix the minimum fees for each course. Means, aapko har course ke liye aapki fees fix honi chahiye. Ye nahi ki aaj itni hai, is saal itni hai, next year itni hai. But it should be fixed. The second grade colleges, like first grade is medical, engineering and all those. But the second grade colleges, which prepare students only for fine arts or some intermediate examination, should be discontinued. Unko khatam kar dena chahiye, unko band kar dena chahiye. This was what he recommended.